All right, hi everybody. Today we have another doubleheader, two conference paper talks. So the first is by Shujon Naja, who's a PhD student, first year PhD student in computer science. He did his master's degree at the University of Manitoba and undergraduate at Bangladesh University of
Engineering
and Technology, Hewitt. And this was a paper at ICPR, which she presented at in Cancun in December. So looking forward to seeing it. Thanks.
So basically here I have summarized like three papers, but like all of them are more or less relevant to zero-shot learning. So I said that I thought like maybe I can like give a presentation of all of them. So let's see. So today we are going to talk about zero-shot learning, and we'll see how we can use zero-shot learning to solve some visual recognition problems. And let's go. So first, what is zero-shot learning? Before describing what is zero-shot learning, let us first have a look at how traditional machine learning system works. So in traditional machine learning system, we train our system with examples from a fixed set of classes. Like here, we are training our system with images of tiger, zebra, cat, and lion. And during testing, we are testing the system with the images of the same set of classes, like tiger, zebra, cat, and lion only. But imagine a scenario where you are training your system with those images of like tiger, zebra, cat, and lion. But during testing, you're giving it images of okapi, kangaroo, ostrich, or maybe an Yeti. So how will your system behave then? This is considered in zero-shot learning. So in zero-shot learning, our goal is to build a model which can classify instances of classes that were extruded during training. So the first problem we're going to discuss is zero-shot object recognition. So in zero-shot object recognition, our goal is to build a classifier which can recognize objects that it has never seen before. Now, how we can do that? How even we human can do that? How we can recognize objects that we have never seen before? So let's give an example. Suppose there's an animal called tapir. I'm not sure how many of you already have seen tapir, but let's assume that you haven't seen tapir before, but you have read about it. We have read that tapir has mane like horses, it has nose like elephant trunk, a smaller version of elephant trunk. It looks like a pygmy hippopotamus, and young tapirs, baby tapirs, have stripes like zebras. So even though you haven't seen a tapir before, but from all those descriptions, can you tell which ones here are tapir? I mean, if you remember that tapir has mane like horses, baby tapirs have stripes like zebras, they look like pygmy hippopotamus, it's pretty obvious that these are the tapirs. So here, we are actually transferring knowledge from our known objects to recognize something completely unknown or unseen. How we can transfer this knowledge? We can do that using symmetric relationship between the known and the unknown object class, unknown classes. And how we can learn these symmetric relationships? We can get those symmetric relationships using attribute using attributes of the object classes. Like here, we can represent the lion. We can represent lion using all those attributes. Yeah, like it's quite, it's brown, it's quite smelly, it's big, it doesn't live on grass, it has paws and has a small tail. So based on all those attributes, we can create a representation of that particular object class. And now, if we want to build a classifier for, suppose, like an unknown class chimpanzee, we can sort all of our known object classes based on their semantic distances to chimpanzee. And if we do that using attribute vector, we see that it's doing a pretty good job here. Like for chimpanzee, you're getting gorilla, spider monkey. For leopard, you're getting German shepherd, bobcat, something like that. So it's pretty good at finding the relevant known classes to a particular unknown object class. But the problem with attribute vector is like it's you have to do that manually. You have to manually label all of the object classes. Like you have to say like how much brown a lion is, and this can be really costly if you have lots of object classes. And Another alternative is to use word vector. Word vector is a vector representation of a word which contains a semantic meaning of that particular word. So if I plot, it gives us a vector representation for each individual word. So if I plot the words based on their word vector, you can see here like the cow, dog, zebra, goat, all of them are like kind of together here. And like suppose trees, buildings, skyscraper, lighthouse, they are together here. So word vector can tell you like what objects are similar and which objects are different. So if we do the same thing here, like try to find the known classes, similar known classes to a particular unknown class based on their word vector distances, we will get something like that. We can see that it can confuse something. Like for chimpanzee, we are getting zero. For leopard, we are getting zebra. So yeah, it can be confusing sometimes and not as good as attributes. But the thing is, it comes for free. You don't have to do anything. Like you can use an unsupervised learning method to do to extract word vector representation for each individual word. So that's pretty helpful if you have like lots of object classes. So now let's see how we can use this attribute vector or word vector, whatever it is. We can call them semantic vectors to transfer knowledge from known object classes to unknown object classes. So first, let's see. Suppose we have the semantic vectors for all of the known classes, which are T1 to TK here, and we have a level vector for particular unknown class, which is S here. So we can use the sparse coding to learn how we can transform all of these known classes level vectors to S. So here we are learning these parameters here. So after we are done, sparse coding will give us this theta1 to theta k parameter. And now once we have those parameters, we are learning a linear classifier, just like a linear SVM or something like that, for each of the known classes, which are W1 to WK here. And then we are using all those parameters we have learned from sparse coding to transform all those classifiers to build a classifier of the unknown class. Now to see like how our model works, we have considered several baselines. Like suppose now we have the linear classifier for all of the known classes. Now suppose we are given an image of an unknown class, and we apply all of our known classifiers on it, and it tells us that it is maybe like a deer or an antelope, which is definitely wrong because it doesn't know which of the it was not trained on the unknown classes. So it gives us a score for a known class. So what we do is like we calculate the distance between this predicted known class to all of the unknown classes, and which one gives us which one is the closest one, we consider that as the level. So we calculate the distance based on their word vectors or the attribute vectors, or also we consider the worded distance as well. So in worded distance, in worded you have all the object classes in a tree-based hierarchy system, where you can calculate where you can tell like whether two objects are two classes are similar based on their hierarchical distance. So now we have tried our model on animal with activity dataset, where we had like 40 known classes and 10 unknown classes, and you can see like our approach is giving best result than all of the baselines, and you can see the attribute based vector is giving us a bit better result than the word vector based approach, which is pretty obvious because our attribute vector is less ambiguous. We tried that on object attribute dataset as well, where we had like 20 known classes and 12 unknown classes. We are getting better results here as well. And finally, we tried that on the ImageNet 112 dataset, where we had 76 known classes and 36 unknown classes. For these dataset, we didn't have any attribute levels, so we use only the word vector, and it kind of gives a better result than all of the results here as well. So so that's all about zero-shot object recognition. The second problem we are going to discuss is novel action recognition from videos. Here our problem is like during training, we are given a bunch of videos and their corresponding sentence descriptions or action levels. Our goal is to build a model which can classify completely novel actions from videos during testing. And also we want to see whether if we give the system any arbitrary sentence query, whether it can find relevant videos from the dataset. So these are the datasets we have tried. You can see like the YouTube dataset here, where we have video, like several videos and corresponding sentence descriptions. There are like several sentence descriptions corresponding to a single video. And we have like USF 101 dataset, where we have videos and their corresponding action classes. So here, what you can do is like we can learn a scoring function, which will give us better score if we give it a relevant video and their corresponding sentence description or direction levels, and it will give us a lower score if we give them like irrelevant videos and sentence descriptions. So before learning the scoring function, we need to first transform all these videos and textual descriptions into like feature vectors. So to transform the video representation, like to get a video feature, we use C3D, which is basically a 3D convolution neural network. It gives a vector representation for a video up to like 20 frames. But most of our training videos and testing videos as well, they contain like more than 20 frames. So we came up with a like temporal pyramid structure where we actually divided the whole video into like two parts and got the C3D feature vector for the first part, got a C3D feature vector for the second part, and then we got a C3D feature vector for the whole video. We concatenate them all and get a like larger feature vector. And for now, to represent the get the feature vector for the sentence descriptions, we can use our old body word vector, but the problem is word vector is only for a single word, but we can have multiple words here because we can have a sentence description. So what we did is that we can get the word vector for each of the words and take the average of them to get a single feature representation for the whole sentence, or we also use a skip thought vector, which basically gives you a single feature vector for the whole sentence. Then we learn this SVM-like optimization function here, which basically learns a weight. So if you give a like relevant video and a relevant sentence description, it will give us a higher score, and it will give us a lower score if you give the irrelevant irrelevant video and sentence description or the action levels. So we learned it using stochastic gradient descent. So the first first experiment we have done is like we are given a query video. We saw like whether our model can rank all of the sentences in the datasets based on their relevancy to the query video. So we use min-rank to measure our performance, which is like if it is lower, it's better. So we are we can see the skip thought vector with the temporal pyramid feature is giving us the best result here. So here we have like 1300 training videos and 610 test videos. Here's an example from the results. So we can see like for this given video, the sentences we are getting is a man and woman are riding a motorcycle. A man and a woman are riding a motorcycle through the streets, which are like pretty relevant. The next problem we try is like we are given a query sentence and we want to see whether the system can rank all of the test videos based on the relevancy to the query sentence. We use the min rank here as well, so we can see the skip thought vector and the temporal pyramid feature is giving us the best result here as well. And this is an example from the test results. So here our query sentence was two teams are playing soccer and we are getting like the videos are mostly relevant. So here for verb only word vector, we see the verb is right, like they are all of them are playing, but definitely that's not soccer. I mean, it got the verb right. Here for this case, we just consider the word vector for the verbs of that particular sentence. So, and finally, we have tried the zero-shot action recognition experiment where we had like, we used the USF11 dataset. We had 91 known action classes and 10 unknown action classes. And here, for this one, like we had just phrases or word vectors. We didn't have a like complex sentence, so we couldn't use skip thought vector here. We just used the mean word vector, and we're getting better results than the baseline here as well. So that was the same. And the third problem we're going to discuss is zero-shot object segmentation. So here, the problem is like, during training, we are given object classes with their segmentation ground truth. Some object classes with their segmentation ground truth, and during testing, we have to segment objects that the model hasn't seen during training. So to do that, we first learned a CNN-based segmentation model on the known object classes. And then we defined it using CRF. So this model will give us a score for each individual pixel of an image. like whether this pixel, what is the probability that this pixel is a cow, belongs to a cow or a cat, something like that. So now to transfer the knowledge from the known classes to segment the unknown object classes, we use the word vectors again, and we also use the word net hierarchy here as well. Word hierarchical distance. So now, suppose we are given an test image of this dolphin. So dolphin is an unknown object. And we apply our segmentation model. The segmentation model we trained on the known object classes on the unknown unknown image, and it gives us a score for all of the known classes. So here, the BR, mouse, bat, they are the like closest object class, the closest known object classes to the unknown object dolphin. And so we just use a weighted summation of these all the scores to get a score vector for a score representation for the unknown class dolphin here, which is ACU, and this one is the visualization of the ACU, which we can see like so combining all those known classes, we are getting a like pretty good score for the unknown class dolphin. And then with this further refinement, we consider the top 20% pixels as positive and the worst 20% pixels as negative, and change another linear classifier using them. And then we apply that on the image again to classify all the pixels. And finally, we use Grafka to further further refine the results. So you can see some like here we had the transfer score, which was SU in the previous slide. And then after applying the appearance model, we are getting a bit better result. And then finally, Grafka is giving us a more refined results. We first applied our model on the image at 445 dataset. So we first trained the segmentation model on the image Coco dataset where we had 80 object classes. And in the image net 444 dataset, we had like 445 unknown object classes. So we are getting like we can say the image hierarchy is giving us better results here. The best results here. And this is some examples from the results where we can see the last two rows are our approach, the result from our approach. And we also applied that on the core dataset. In core dataset, we have like 27 object classes, 10 of which conflicts with the Coco dataset, so we excluded those 10 object classes from Coco dataset. So we trained this time like the known object classifier using 70 classes from MS Coco dataset, and applied that on the core dataset here. So we can see like here we're getting better results than all of the baselines here as well. And this is the examples from some of the some of the test examples. That's kind of all.
So I have a question. It's always interesting in the zero shot stuff to look at the errors and the confusion matrices that you showed. And I noticed that some of them made a lot of sense and some of them didn't. And I wondered, the ones that didn't make sense, do you have any reason for what the confusion was? So for instance, there was applying lipstick was really confused with front crawl.
So which one?
Applying lipstick and front crawl.
The action?
Yeah, and during action, for instance. And there was one that was like, yeah, here,
uh-huh,
for instance.
Uh-huh.
So do you have any intuition for why that would be so high? Because it seems like other things here seem much closer together than those two.
For zero shot running, it's mostly based on like how much for applying lipstick, this was an unknown action. For this one, I guess like we had much known actions which are like pretty relevant to this one. But yeah, right now I can't remember like what known actions were there. Like so, applying lipstick got like so better results.
But I mean, does that suggest that there's some commonalities between those two actions that aren't us, or is it learning some, is it queuing on some bias or something? Or?
Yeah, there can be. The thing is, like, because most of them are based on the word vector, because for this one, I just had word vector.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, like, word vectors are, I mean, they're good, but they're pretty mysterious. I mean, you can always tell, like, I mean, if you see that, for this one, you see, bird and zebra, they are very similar.
Uh-huh.
But the thing is, actually, they're definitely not similar in visual, like, similarities, but they appear in text, like, so many times together that the word vector thinks they are pretty close.
I see. So does that mean that applying lipstick and front crawl somehow appears together in text a lot?
I think I'm not exactly sure, but there can be a, yeah, that can be the reason.
Sure. Sorry, but because you showed like three different applications, I was forgetting over time like what exactly your method was and how it's common across. Can you give me like a three sentence description about how exactly you do one shot learning?
Zero shot
learning. Sorry.
the first thing is that actually
one shot learning is also a thing.
Yeah, it is. And it's actually a pretty good. I mean, for zero shot learning, the problem is you have to find something else. I mean, like, you know, suppose for the, so for the, yeah, for the object recognition thing, I haven't done any kind of training here. It was just like, you have, I have the attribute vectors or the word vectors for the known object class and unknown object classes.
Right.
I mean, which can be like, they can be shared attributes. I mean, word vector can be a bit confusing, but like, if you just think about the shared attributes, the example I gave about Tapir, because you had you have these attributes, like you know that Tapir has these attributes, but you haven't seen a Tapir before. But when you go to the jungle and you say, okay, I have heard that Tapir has these attributes, like similar to my known object classes, then you say, okay, I can see like these animal has those attributes, so I can just tell that this is the Tapir. So in terms of a method I applied here is, you just learn a parameter vector which can transform your attribute vectors, like the it's just like kind of like weighted summation, but sparse weighted summation vectors of the unknown classes to generate the level vector for the unknown class.
But for this, in order to learn these parameters,
uh-huh,
don't you need to plug the unknown classes in there? So you need to know of the existence of the unknown classes.
The problem of this system is like, it's not unknown, it's unseen. I think term is sometimes a bit confusing. You know there exists an object, there exists an animal called Tapir, but you have just never seen it.
So loud. The reason I was interested is because I read a paper on one-shot learning, which is a similar idea.
Yeah.
And here the idea is that you don't encounter the class until testing at all.
No, I guess for one-shot, you have, I mean, like, at least one example or something like that during training. Because zero-shot means, like, you have absolutely no idea what about the test classes during training.
Yeah.
So you have to use some other techniques, like other semantic meanings to, like, find which object classes are similar. But for one shot, I guess like you can use at least like one or very few examples during training, but you just need to, you know, like generalize them.
Yeah.
So I mean, for this one, like for the zero shot object recognition, like I just like learned those parameters, and you know, I learned these parameters how I can transform the known object attributes to the unknown object view, and I just use those parameters to transform the known classifiers to the unknown classifier. And for the action recognition thing, here I basically learned an embedding. I think this one is like pretty common these days, like where you are actually trying to learn a common embedding. Where I mean, I'm projecting both the video and that sentence description to a common embedding, so you can tell them whether they are like similar or not.
Thank you.
Any questions? I'll ask one follow-up question instead. So the reason I'm asking you this is recently somebody other than Sven and I got in an argument about zero one-shot learning, and we were each confusing ourselves sort of about exactly the thing that Sven just asked, but then we were also having an argument about how useful zero-shot learning is compared to one-shot learning. So do you have some sort of example of when you would really have zero examples as opposed to one?
Well, yeah, actually, I can't remember, but I read one paper which I think coined the term zero-shot learning or something like that, and there's one example there which said, like, think of, like, you want to... I am not sure, maybe it's from Jeff Hinton or something, someone like that, but he mentioned that suppose you want to find what word you are thinking based on your MRI responses. Something like that, for which you really can't have lots of examples. I mean, in some scenarios where you really don't even know what can be that class, you have an input, but finding an output is really, really hard. I mean, you can never tell that, yes, I am definitely, I will not have this, class during testing, or I'll have something like that. So in scenarios where you have absolutely no, you are not sure that whether you can have this class during testing or not, then you have no way. But because even for one-shot learning, you need at least one example. But think about, like, meeting with aliens. You have never seen aliens. What if you see an alien? Then how do you classify him? I mean, you can't have an example of an alien.
Yeah. So I guess in the first example of the MRI, it's that there's so many classes.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
Huge number
of words.
Classes.
Think of words.
Yeah.
Objects. I mean, my main motivation, my first motivation was working on the zero-shot learning. The problem is, like, I guess, like, one-shot is, like, more practical for us. Like, I mean, we human are pretty good at, like, we can, if we see one object, then we can, like, classify it ever later. But for zero-shot learning, the problem is, it's a bit hard to find the examples.
Right.
But the thing is, I know. I mean, also, like, for the generative models these days, like, everyone working with, for they are also kind of learning these kind of embeddings. You think, like, their paper, like, where you are generating images from sentence descriptions, you are doing just the same thing what I'm doing here, because you're learning common embedding. So you don't have to get all of the words. You don't have to get all the sentences to generate an image. You learn that just a common embedding where you can, like, project the sentence or the image, and you can, like, you can have any arbitrary sentence, like, image for any arbitrary sentence description. You don't have to learn all of them.
Right. Okay. All right. Well, thank you.